This is Musical Talk.
Musical Talk.
The UK's independent musical theatre podcast.
Musical Talk. The UK independent musical theatre podcast.
Hello, Nick Hudson here. Lovely to be back with you on Musical Talk. I hope you enjoyed Foss's Edinburgh episodes. This week, we're going to be having a discussion with Christina Bianco, who is currently featuring in Forbidden Broadway at the Vaudeville Theatre. But before that, you're going to hear a discussion I had with Professor Robert Gordon, where he and I discussed Forbidden Broadway's latest revival at the Vaudeville Theatre. I'm here with Professor Robert Gordon, and once again we're going to be discussing Forbidden Broadway. You'll forgive my voice, I'm getting a cold coming on, Robert, but Jonathan Cohen and I went to see it at the Meunier, and it was absolutely brilliant. You can listen to our review of that a couple of episodes back, but then it was announced that it was moving to the Vaudeville Theatre on the Strand with Christina Bianco, so that got my interest piqued a bit more, because I'm a big fan of her. Robert, I've introduced her slightly to you, hadn't I? But you weren't that aware of her immense ability.
Yes, I had no idea. I'd not really listened to Christina Bianco. I'd read about her. No, I found her massively impressive as a performer. She has an astonishing vocal range. One of the things that impressed me most was her impersonation of Christine Chenoweth. She not only did
Kristen Chenoweth.
Kristen Chenoweth. Okay. Not only did she manage to do a what is probably easier, a sort of a caricature of her little girl voice, the thing that she uses for Galinda in Wicked, but she actually did. There's a parody of a very famous song with a coloratura range. From Leonard Bernstein's Candide, and it was changed from Glitter and Be Gay to Glitter and Be Glib, and she sang the coloratura almost as well, I think you could say, as well as Kristen Chenoweth did. And Kristen Chenoweth has an extraordinary operatic voice. So does Christine Bianco.
Yes, or Christina Bianco. Even.
Okay, Christina Bianco.
Yes, you'll be hearing from Christina Bianco later on in this discussion, where she does talk about how that song came to be in this production of Forbidden Broadway. There is more to Forbidden Broadway than Christina Bianco, though, we should say. It's an all-round great ensemble piece, isn't it, Robert?
Yes, I did see it a number of years ago, so some of the pieces which are very famous by now, which are done very often and that are still being done in the show, are the parody of Les Mis, where everybody goes round and round and round on a turntable, and it is very funny still. I don't know if they update it a bit, but it is it, from time to time.
Why have they? They never updated Les Mis, so why should they?
Absolutely. But this is a parody of the old the Trevor Nunn staging of Les Mis.
The Miss Saigon section is a mixture of new material and old material, and that's now a big part of the show, obviously, because of Miss Saigon coming back.
Yes, and I think that's what's good also about what they're doing in London, because they have chosen shows, not just British shows, but shows that are very well known and that are running in London. And I think that's there's a real buzz from an audience who have seen some of these shows. You can feel that the audience recognises the parody. It is in a way a very affectionate parody, although it's critical in many, many ways, which I think are quite interesting and genuinely political, if you like, because I thought that one of the songs that they sing about the sort of advance of the corporate sector in America, who are taking over who really have taken over as producers on Broadway, was very clever and very hard hitting.
Doesn't work here, though, does it?
No, it doesn't mean the same thing here. I don't think the audience quite got it in the same way.
I mean, we have things like at the Piccadilly Theatre. If you look at we have the American Airlines bar, which is about as classy as it sounds,
yes.
But we don't really have the American Airlines theatre, which they do on Broadway.
Absolutely.
That is correct, isn't it?
That's right. And you can't really call ATG a corporation in the same way as McDonald's.
So that was the finale to the piece. The bit that, I mean, Christine and I talk about slightly is the fact that they parodied Evita before it had even got reviews.
Yes, well, of course, Evita's very well known anyway, so it's always easy to do a parody of Evita, but, you know, even if you haven't seen the current production. But I think, yes, it was quite hard-hitting, and I think, actually, I heard someone behind me gasping, as if somehow this was rather rude, because they're parodying the Portuguese actress, I can't remember her name, That's quite cool, really. That they're sort of ahead of the game in that sense.
Obviously, playing on the fact that it is a Ken Wright production, so they talk about how the sets are small and cardboard and falling over and stuff like
Again,
that.
Again, it's very rude, and I wonder what Bill Ken Wright thinks about that. They're saying
promotion for his show.
It's very cheap, they say. You know, cheap. Ken Wright is famous for cheap productions. But I think that's also what I liked about it, is the directness and the rudeness. And I heard that, in fact, that there's a teasing, not terribly vicious satire, of Robert Lindsay in Dirty Rotten Scoundrels.
Yes, that was new as well.
Yes, and apparently he'd been in to see the show the night before you and I saw it, and he enjoyed it. So I think actually people are rather flattered.
I think as a performer, you're not going to say, oh, I really hate that, can you remove it from the show? Because it's all promotion for what he's doing, and it gets people talking about him. We have to remember what actors are like.
Well, I think also clever producers realise this is great advertising.
Yeah, it's only over the road as well.
There's no such thing as bad publicity. So I think people like McIntosh, who are parodied in different ways, directly in the show, are quite flattered to be parodied in that way. And of course, people will go and see the shows once they've heard the parody.
Once is always the highlight of this show for me, because I don't think Once is a great piece at all. I think there's a lyric that they do in Forbidden Broadway version of Once where they say, is it we're so pretentious we're now unpretentious or something?
Something like that, yes. I think it's for
it
good.
It really pits out the flaws in the piece, though.
I think they do. At times, they're uncannily accurate as critics of the shows they're analysing. At other times, it's very broad brush. I mean, to be honest,
Liza One Note, for example.
Well, the Liza One Note doesn't work anymore, I don't think, because first of all, to be honest, though, she's a wonderful performer. I don't think Anna Jane Casey gets the Liza voice in any way. But the other thing is that the Christina Bianco's impersonations are so accurate. And the Liza One Note has been going on for a long time, and they haven't updated it precisely enough. The thing that I really thought, apart from Kristen Chenoweth, the two impersonations, the other ones that Christina Bianco does, one is of Bernadette Peters, which is don't come and see me on the Sunday, you know, it's parodying Tell Me on a Sunday, and she sort of croaks see me on a Monday please, which is very funny because it's quite well known.
Especially as we were seeing it on a Monday.
We were seeing it on a Monday. It's quite well known that Bernadette Peters has lost her voice by Friday very often, and the voice is getting more and more ragged. It's a brilliant impersonation of her cutesy speaking voice and a clever impersonation of her singing. But the other one is Idina Menzel, again showing her great range. But Idina Menzel is a singer who irritates me particularly, because although she's got a huge following, the voice is becoming a bit of a cliche, very mannered. And she gets the power of the voice and the nasality of the voice, and it's very funny and very accurate. I think there are some of the older parodies, as I say, they should probably put them to rest now, but they're easy targets.
Well, one thing we had at the Menier was a Julie Andrews song called I Couldn't Hit the Note, because Christina Bianco does an absolutely scarily good Julie Andrews impression, so I was looking forward to her doing that, and we didn't get that. And in the interview, Christina talks about the running order of the show is very carefully planned, because you can't have someone who's just sung a song do another song, because there'll be, you know, they need to rest their voice, or they need to change their costume, or they need to get something ready for the next performance. And it's a kind of, it's a domino effect, essentially. So if you did see it at the Menier, go and see it again, because it's almost like it's a different show. And it's in a real theatre, which makes a lot more sense, as opposed to the most widescreen theatre in the world, which is the Menier.
It's a very, very well-performed show. I think all the performers are superb. We've picked out Christina.
Damien Humbley's still in it as well.
Damien Humbley's wonderful. Anna Jane Casey is great. So is the Ben Lewis, I think, the Australian performer. They're all very good as singers and performers. So you're actually watching a show that gives you double pleasure. At times, they sing so well, you can enjoy that. But, of course, the parodies are fun and at times quite devastating.
And what I love, I talked about this in my other review with Jonathan, is I love the way the parody extends beyond the songs. We have costume parody. We even have lighting parody as well. For example, at the end of Defying Gravity, I talked about this as well, the lighting is the same cue as it is, you know, you're paying £95 for that effect at the Apollo Victoria, and here you are getting it at the Vaudeville.
Well, I think in that sense it's a real insider's show. Mm. So they know all the details of the shows they're parodying. They're not, in most cases, they're not just broad brush.
There is a touching moment in the show, and that's the beautiful song from Dear World called I Don't Want to Go or I don't want to know or whatever.
The wonderful song which Angela Lansbury sang in the original production of Dear World, which is I Don't Want to Know. She comes on as Angela Lansbury in the current incarnation as in Blythe's spirit, Madame as Madame Arcati, and she sings, you know, if the prices are so bad and if the prices are so high and the singers are so bad, then I don't want to go.
My favourite lyric is Plato isn't writing the... If Plato isn't philosophizing, I don't want to go.
Yes, it's
our age.
Yes, it's quite clever. It's not the funniest number in the show, but it's...
No, but it's more touching, I think, especially as a British audience. We've just seen Angela Lansbury on stage. It was nice that they put that in.
Well, they're saying something about how Broadway has changed since Lansbury became a star. It's actually more commercialised, that the rise of the, you know, the global corporations are making more anodyne, more shows which are more anodyne and shows which are loud, not witty and not particularised and not emotionally as detailed as the shows used to be. You know, we see that in most of the numbers where we're given parodies of people really belting out high, you know, long notes, power ballads, which is very different from the kind of show you would have seen in the 60s, which was much more jazzy and witty.
Well, we have sort of 1.5 new songs written for specific London productions. We have the Matilda parody and the younger brother of Matilda, the Charlie and the Chocolate Factory parody. What did you think of those, Robert?
I thought they were brilliant. I don't want to give away the joke in the Matilda parody, but it's very, very funny, very wicked, and in a sense, probably quite true. It's a protest against the exploitation of child performers.
And the Charlie and Chocolate Factory parody, that when you hear that joke that comes so seamlessly out of the song, it's so clever, isn't it?
Yes, definitely. I mean, they've really listened, and they've really, you know, they know Broadway, and they know what's impressive is they've got to know the West End too.
What I do like about the show is that, as I said, they haven't just said move it into the Vaudeville, and you know they've written stuff for it, they've cut stuff out, they've switched things around. When I saw it at the Menier, this shows how quick changes are. We had a pajama game parody. Yes. Which now isn't in it because the pyjama game is now dead and gone.
Yes, I mean, the other thing to say is that Pianist is absolutely brilliant.
Yes. At the Menier, we have the show's current MD, Joel Fram, and at the Vaudeville, the night we saw it, I don't know if they alternate, but we had the very, very talented Andy Massey. Now, Andy Massey is one of the greatest pianists in the country for theatre. If you're familiar with the Mary Poppins London cast recording, he's playing some of the incredibly difficult piano stuff on that. So that is Andy Massey. Well done to you, sir. Well, but would you go again? I mean, do you think this show should become a summer tradition in London?
It's not something you can see a number of times within a given time frame. I have seen it, I'd say, I think I saw it about 12 years ago, the version that was current, was in London 12 years ago. So I wouldn't want to go, because it would be spoilt, I wouldn't want to go within a year or so. But perhaps in 5 years' time, when there's, you know, another incarnation, yes, certainly.
Did you think the Les Mis skit and the Miss Saigon skit outstayed their welcome a bit in the evening?
I thought perhaps the Les Mis skit did, because although it's very funny, you get the joke quite early on. I know, I thought the Miss Saigon skit, because Miss Saigon is on again, and I've just seen it.
Saigon and on and on and on.
It was, yes, I think it was to the point, and I didn't know what was going to happen next, and so with that one, I bought it.
Well, you can buy tickets for Forbidden Broadway, and I seriously suggest you do. Thank you very much, Robert.
Thank you, Nick.
And now I'm going to hand you over to the interview I did with the absolutely fabulous Christina Bianco. It's an absolute pleasure to be talking to Christina Bianco here on Musical Talk. Hello, Christina. How are you?
I'm very well, thank you. A bit sleepy, but very good.
Yes, well, it is 1:20 in the afternoon on a Monday, so one has the right to feel.
I should preface that. I got up early. I had the privilege this morning of being on the TV show The Right Stuff. So not only did I have to wake up early and, you know, be on camera ready, but I had to actually talk with some amount of sense about some political matters. So I did definitely, I feel like I had a real jump start to the day. day, shot out of a cannon.
Well, I'm glad you saved your good conversation till this afternoon for us.
Yes, I did save it for you. Very good.
So you find yourself in London. You're a confessed Anglophile, aren't you?
Yes, I am. I'm very unapologetic about it because it's pretty easy to see from my interests, if you follow me on, you know, Twitter and Facebook and all that, that, yeah, I was that odd child that grew up watching tons and tons of Monty Python, Blackadder, absolutely fabulous, even a bit of Fry and Laurie. That I just watched that stuff as a kid. Half of it went over my head, but I enjoyed it immensely.
You're here doing Forbidden Broadway, and when I saw you in Forbidden Broadway, I felt very honoured to be seeing Bernadette Peters on stage.
Aww.
Do you think watching the British shows gave you an ear for accents at that young age?
I do. I think, you know, my parents are really good about exposing me to not only different styles of music, which helped me immensely find my voice and find other people's voices through impression, but also they were very open-minded about film and literature and television, and they tried to expose me to as much as they could. And although they're not incredibly well world traveled or anything, they just really I think they wanted me to learn about stuff outside of my own culture. So I do think listening to those accents from a young age did make it easy for me to do. Some of the best compliments I've had so far from Forbidden Broadway have not been about my impressions. They've been about, oh, your British accent was really good and the different styles. So I take that as quite a compliment, hearing that from the Brits themselves.
Well, you do an amazing Elaine Page.
Thank you. I studied that one. I love her to death.
You've done Forbidden Broadway before, is that correct?
Yes. I did Forbidden Broadway about 6 years ago in New York City. And at the time, it was absolutely the thrill of my life. It still would be. I love the show. It is now doing it here. I grew up watching Forbidden Broadway. I went to see all of the different editions because every new Broadway season, they'd come out with a new edition of Forbidden Broadway. Mm-hmm. And there were cast recordings I'd make my parents go out and get. It was so much fun for me, who loved to sing and loved to perform from a young age. It seemed to be the coolest job one could have. To be an actor in that show, you got to sing a million different styles and a million different, you know, from all the different shows. And it was really, it was like getting paid to play dress up and do all these characters. I thought it looked like the most fun job. And so when I was cast in the show, it was really a dream come true. All of a sudden, I'd listened to these people on the cast recording and I sort of emulated them. And now I was working with them and I was on a cast album myself. So it's so crazy and really just fortuitous that 6 years later, it's back in my life. And I get to do it on such a grand scale as here at the West End and at the Vaudeville Theatre.
Can you remember the first Forbidden Broadway sketch you saw?
Don't remember the first one I saw, but I do remember the first album, and I can tell you about the sketch on the album. I remember that it was Forbidden Broadway Volume 3, and my favorite track to play was the Miss Saigon spoof.
Right.
And I remember this because I hadn't seen the show. My parents had seen it. I hadn't seen it yet. But I sang along with them with conviction as if I knew everything they were talking about. And now, because Miss Saigon is back, I actually get to perform that number in this show. I couldn't believe it when I saw the running order and I said, oh my gosh, I actually get to sing this number. Of course, it's been updated, but the basic principles are the same.
Bit like the show, really.
Yeah. Well, I haven't seen it, so I can't comment. But
I saw Forbidden Broadway at the Menier.
Yeah.
And you weren't in it. The wonderful Sophie Louise Dan was in it, but she's doing Maid in Dagenham now. So you were brought in, and I thought I'm really excited to see you. And what I love about it is the show wasn't a carbon copy of the Menier production. It had new stuff put in it, even as far as to go for the cruel/hilarious Evita sketch.
Yeah, that one's a bit hitting a few sore spots, but I think they really wanted to be topical. I think the writer, Gerard Alessandrini, and the director, Philip George, they really wanted people that had seen it at the Menier to have reasons to come back. Mm. And Forbidden Broadway always has been topical, so it always changes. So it makes sense that it would change now for the shows. I mean, obviously, Pajama Game is now gone, so the Pajama Game sketch is gone. That's my sleepiness creeping in. But you have to reflect that in Forbidden Broadway.
When were you made aware of the fact you were coming to do it in London?
Not very long before I had to come, to be honest with you. I thought it was a bit too good to be true. I was approached by David Babani, who had, you know, seen my work and, obviously knew that I did Forbidden Broadway in New York. And I guess him and the creative team and the director, they decided that if they were going to go for some change in bringing it to the West End. A part of that change could be bringing in me, the American actress known for doing it in America. And it was such a shock because it was going to happen very quickly. You know, I believe the transfer happened quickly. You know, you think you have to snatch up the theater space when it's available, particularly when you're filling a slot, as I believe this show was. It was quite quick. I was about to go to Edinburgh, and I was working on that show, really crafting and trying to create a show that I did in the Edinburgh Festival called Devolution. So I was working on that show. I was
nice
also
to hear an American who can pronounce it properly.
Thank you very much. Not Edinburgh,
no.
The way we say it. Well, you better get it right if you're going to go. That's what I say.
But many Americans wouldn't.
Oh, see? Thank you. I appreciate that. And so when I went to Edinburgh, I thought I would be working, once my show was up there, working on the show that I was going to do at the Hippodrome in September, my solo shows. But instead of all that, I found myself frantically trying to memorize and learn Forbidden Broadway. So it was very fast and furious, but I'm pretty good under pressure. And I was very excited and very eager, so that certainly makes it easier to learn when you're excited. And so in my downtime, I really didn't get to explore the city as much as I wanted to. I was sort of stuck in my apartment learning lyrics. Now, a lot of the music, you know, of course, the melodies to the songs you know from Forbidden Broadway, so that's certainly a bonus. But, you know, Forbidden Broadway is one of those shows where very often you might have to switch numbers with the other actress in the show because of costume changes. There are only four people in the cast. So if you end one number, you really can't begin the next one. And the order of the sketches in Forbidden Broadway is so important for the pacing and timing of the show and the ebb and flow. So it just so happened that almost all the numbers I'd done in New York, Anna Jane Casey was already doing here. So I really did have to learn things anew, have a fresh start on the show, which was really exciting, but definitely a little nerve-wracking because it all happened so quickly.
I felt completely honored to witness your glitter and be glib performance. To sing that song as the character from Candide is impressive, but to do it as Kristen Chenoweth doing it as the character, I mean, and it's not the easiest song in the world. You're hitting some notes I've never heard of, probably.
Thank you. It's I have to say, it's my favorite thing to do in the show, and I didn't expect to get to do it here. Although Kristen Chenoweth is still popular, not to be wicked. Yeah, I didn't really mean to do that, but there you go. Although she's definitely more well known in the U.S. than she is here. But I think it helps. I mean, she just performed at Royal Albert Hall, and again, you do want to put things in Forbidden Broadway that are for everyone. So that means putting in, obviously, the numbers that spoof Lion King and Wicked and Les Mis and Phantom, numbers that everybody knows because everybody's seen those shows or at least seen footage and clips or heard music. And then there are the things for the more theater insiders. So maybe not everybody in the audience knows exactly who Kristen Chenoweth is. Maybe they know of her and they know her voice, her squeaky little voice, but maybe they don't know about her and her career. So again, you just have to hope that the audience is appreciating some part of the performance. I'm very grateful they did. We tried it in the previews, and I was very ready for the number to be cut from the show if it didn't work. You have to be prepared for that, you know. I can't be a diva about it. I have to do what's best for the show, as fun as that number is. I don't want to do it to a bunch of people.
You can't be too like Kristen Chenoweth.
Yeah, I don't know. No. I don't want to do it to an audience full of people with their arms crossed looking confused. So I'm so glad it's gone over well. And because that number in particular was written for me for the New York production, to get to do it here, looking up at not one but two balconies at a theater in the West End, that moment is very special to me every evening.
I think the theater-going crowd do go to Forbidden Broadway because, I mean, you'll forgive me, it's a wonderful show, but it's not really something that tourists off the street will come and go to.
Well, they do. It's just not as many as the knowledgeable theater goer. And I do, and I really do like to say that, yeah, tourists do come. I mean, that's the reason the show has lasted 28-30 years in New York, and it did play, has always played smaller venues, but it's really lasted, and it can't do that alone on the theater insiders. You know, it has to attract the attention of some of the theater goers, the tourists who come, and they, every time they come to town, be it London or New York, they come to see the theater and they see the musicals. So those people will get much of the show. They might take away something different than the quote-unquote theater insiders, but it does really appeal to a wide group of people, which is why it's fun to do. And it certainly makes every performance different because there are certain bits They get huge laughs one night, they don't the next, just because of the make of the audience. So it's fun.
And did you have any input into the running order, or was it just thrust upon you and you were told, learn this and see you in a few weeks?
Yeah, no, that is true. I don't have any input. It is absolutely the creative team. It's the writer and the director. But the nice thing is because the show is for people, it's so intimate, it's so close, particularly the director, Philip George, he's very good. Once the writer's given him the material and he's sort of proposed an order, then it's up to the director to sort of figure out what actually plays in front of the live audience and what can the actors do, how is it balanced. And it's their job, the creative team's job, to make sure that the show showcases all of us equally. So it's not, you know, the Christina show or the Anna Jane Casey show. You know, you really have to balance the numbers out well, so not only the audience can appreciate it and have a nice ebb and flow, but so that we as performers can deal with it and handle it regarding stamina and vocal ability, because we all get to sing these incredible diva songs and you know, male as well, these incredible songs that are sort of very often the 11 o'clock number of a show. So essentially we have, you know, 20 11 o'clock numbers in a row in our show. So yes, it's tough. So they really brilliantly put together an order, but it does often change once it's on its feet. You see what's feasible and what's not.
And you mentioned it is a team effort. And what I did like about the show is that, and you'll forgive me for saying this again, there wasn't the kind of, and here's Christina Bianco doing her 27 impressions in one song moment, which I thought we were going to have.
Yeah, no, that would have been inappropriate. That's something that Christina Bianco does as a solo performer. That's not something that Christina Cast in Forbidden Broadway would do. And so, no, they're very good about that. I mean, it's nice for me, because now that most of the world, like, I'm so famous, I'm not, but I'm recognized by people now because of the worldwide YouTube sort of fame I've had now on the internet. Those people know me for just being on a stage as myself, doing impressions or maybe ending a song on my own voice, but they know me as that. And I am an actress and I am a performer that's done this for many years and I went to school for it. It's a nice natural progression to have me in a show where I do get to do a few impressions, but I'm also being a singer and an actress, just flat out. And that's what's nice, is that it gives the people that may know Internet Christina a chance to see that and then more. But for me, yeah, I would have been very reluctant if they'd even suggested a number like that to put it in the show, because it's not appropriate. Unless it's fitting to the Broadway or West End shows that are up there, it doesn't make sense to be in the show. When I do my live performances and my solo shows, like I just did at the Hippodrome a few weeks ago, I always make sure to split the show 50-50 between my own voice and impressions. It's you know, evenly distributed throughout the show. It's not like I do the first act as me and second act in impressions, but it's really nice, and the audience does not mind. The audience likes it. They more than don't mind. They appreciate it because it makes the show well-rounded. For me, if I just did impressions, it sort of can lose its... You can lose interest. It can be quite dull. It becomes expected. But if I do something in my own voice in between, they're reminded of what I sound like, and then hearing the impression actually becomes that much more impressive.
Yeah.
And it adds some variety to the show.
When was the moment you realized you could do these tricks? Was it something you wanted to do? Was it something someone told you you could do?
No, it was my parents tell me that I did voices, quote unquote, from a very young age. I did it without realizing it. I would sing along to recordings and just inadvertently mimic what I had heard, sort of like listening to the music and singing along like a parakeet, you know, just picking up on the sounds. My mom would say to me, Christina, sing it like yourself. Don't sing it like the recording. But that's all I took from it. I mean, it was something that came naturally to me, but I never saw it as an impression. I was too young to even sort of know what that was. Years later, I made friends laugh. I remember singing along to Celine Dion, sort of, I love her, but I was sort of poking fun at the way she pronounced something. Everybody laughed and said, that's so good, you sound just like her. And I took a little mental note of that, and it was sort of a party trick after that. Mm-hmm. But still, I never took it seriously until I auditioned for Forbidden Broadway in New York City. I was, you know, older, working, an adult, and all of a sudden I saw an audition for Forbidden Broadway, and I was no longer the kid singing along in my bedroom in my parents' house. I was, you know, a working actor living in New York City. I am an adult now. I should be able to audition for this. So I locked myself in my apartment, and I tried to do as many impressions as I could. And I didn't see them even so much as dead-on impressions because I didn't know if they were any good at that point. I just saw it as, well, you have to change your voice a little bit to sound like these people because that's what they did in Forbidden Broadway. So I remember I tried to do Bernadette Peters, who is one of my all-time favorites. Really, I looked up to her so much, and I still do as a musical theater performer. And I called my mom, and I said, Mom, who does this sound like? And I started singing Bernadette Peters singing Joanna from Sweeney Todd off the first Sondheim album. That's what I chose to use in the audition. And my mom was like, oh, my God, you sound like Bernadette Peters. I can't believe that. How'd you do that? I didn't know you could do this. So it gave me a little confidence that I wouldn't embarrass myself completely at the audition. But when I got the job and then I was actually, you know, performing, suddenly thrust onto the live stage, performing my impressions in front of an audience. And then I was lucky enough to get good reviews and lucky enough to get a Drama Desk Award nomination. Let me tell you, that will motivate you. Yes. Give you confidence to try more and more. So it was really only by practice, like only by actually getting up there and doing it, that I had fun. And then it really made me want to try more with impressions. And that's what I'm doing now.
People like Bernadette and Judy Andrews, they all have such unique voice. I mean, their voices are so... I mean, I don't know what the heck Bernadette Peters is doing with her voice, but that's...
Well, it's normal for her. For her, yeah. It's just opening her mouth and talking. But to us, it sounds so pinchy and funny.
And have any of these, since your rise to stardom, have you been able to now meet any of these idols of yours?
And no, and I am so bored by saying no every time somebody asks me that. I wish somebody would come and see what I do. I know that in Forbidden Broadway, many, many people have come in the past, but for the audition that I was in, nobody that I impersonated at the time came. I'm aware that I think Kristen Chenoweth is aware of who I am and that I sort of mimic her. Somebody tweeted one of my videos to her, and she tweeted back, "Fabulous!" So that, I've got that. So hopefully she really did think it was fabulous.
Well, that's a quote now. Fabulous, says Christine Chenoweth.
I know. I haven't used it yet. I haven't been brave enough, but I keep that one. I just keep it for myself. I know that Elaine Page came to see Forbidden at the Meunier. So I don't know if she'll come back and see this one, but I hope she does because I really love her. She's another one like Kristen Chenoweth and myself, a 4'11" actress. Aww. And I've always just sort of been so proud to be a part of what I call the 411 Club with all these little ladies with big voices. And I think it's very important for particularly a petite actress like me. Very often it's very, very, very hard for me to even get seen for work because of my height. So I always look up to these women who have triumphed. Yeah. Yeah, well, I guess I look them in the eye, but they've triumphed, and so I really love Elaine Page. I would love to meet her.
Have you counted them now?
Counted how many impressions I do?
Yes.
Well, it's over with speaking impressions. It's well over 60, but I haven't. I don't. You know what? Somebody told me, you know, I don't know if I put 19 divas on the video title that I did, but someone said you should put the number of people you do. I said, that's not right, because then everybody's just counting the number and then you have to do more than the last time. It's not the amount. I hope it's not the amount that impresses people. I hope it's the quality of the impressions. And so I don't really count, but I do know now that, yeah, it's over 60 that I do.
Well, I mean, what really amazes me is your impressions, but your bloody good singer as well, which I think we talked about. But this is my favorite recording you've ever done. I think I found it on your website, I believe, is a wonderful kind of cabaret recording in a cabaret.
Oh, Eugene Cabaret. Yeah. That's my personal favorite as well. So thank you. I'm
listening to it. Oh, there's a Top C at the end by Kristen Chenoweth. Do you have to take care of your voice more than other singers? Because you're obviously doing strange manipulative things to it.
Yes and no. I don't want to jinx anything, knock on wood. I have very, you know, healthy, strong vocal cords. And when I started doing impressions more regularly and performing them out and traveling and doing concerts and doing solo gigs, and I realized I was stretching my voice in ways I hadn't before. And I got a little nervous that I might be hurting myself. So I went to the doctor sort of freaking out, you know, the ear, nose, and throat doctor, saying, I need the scope, I hope everything's okay. And he checked everything out and said I was doing just fine. So what I try to do is what most singers try to do. Sleep is the most important thing. I'm running on empty right now, but sleep is very important for the vocal cords, and nothing beats water. You know, I'm not afraid to have a drink if I want one after a show. I'm not afraid to walk around. You won't see me with a scarf draped around my neck or anything like that.
But I think it's theatrical.
I think it's common sense. I find the hardest thing is being in noisy restaurants or bars trying to have a conversation. That's way more damaging to me.
Yeah.
To your voice and very hard on the voice. Like right now, I'm noticing that I'm a little hoarse. And I think it's because I didn't sleep very well and I spent the morning talking.
Oh, your voice, sorry.
So after I stop talking to you, I will probably have a nice throat coat tea. I get this tea called Throat Coat that I really like. And I'll have a lot of water. And I'll probably do a longer warm-up today. It's mm-hmm. just little things, you know. Well, you hopefully know your own voice quite well, so I just try to listen to it and not abuse it.
Now I feel bad.
No, please, it was not meant to make you feel bad.
You're here doing Forbidden Broadway until when?
November 22nd.
That's a healthy run. And do you have plans for any other upcoming? I mean, you mentioned the Hippodrome. You were here.
Yeah, I played the 5th, 6th, and 7th at the Hippodrome. Of September, I already did it, yeah.
And are you planning any more shows for there?
We're working on it. I was so lucky. Once again, I've come to London and the fans have been so great. I sold out all my shows again and there were a lot of people that didn't get a chance to see it. And I unveiled a brand new show and it went over very well and I'm very proud of it. So I'm looking to book more dates of the show. When is yet to be determined, but I do believe I'll be back in London with that show. I called it Christina Bianco Party of One. So keep an eye out for that. I'll certainly post about it on my website.
Lovely, very much. And where can people go to find out more information about you, Christina?
ChristinaBianco.com. Nice and easy.
Of course it would be. Thank you very much, Christina.
Thank you.
And what are you telling me? No, I can't stand it!
This has been a production of Musical Talk, copyright 2014.